Hello and welcome everybody to a very special edition of the Buy Round interview show. We are joined today by a person in many people's eyes, the greatest rugby league player that has ever graced this planet, an immortal Wally Lewis.
And many people south of the border say he was a wanker anyway. He couldn't play. He was just a Queenslander that we hated and used to boo at every opportunity. And James, I've got to say that that was probably the biggest inspiration for me playing footy. And I'm sure you were the same. If you had people doubting your talent on the field or cheering for the other side, you just wanted to prove them wrong.
There is something about being booed and being hated by another set of supporters that can bring out the best in people, isn't there?
Yeah, it does. Yeah, you love to prove them wrong. And, I'm probably jumping a little bit ahead the schedule here, but some of those Queensland games where I used to say to the players at full time, thank the fans. I said, down here, I said, they probably didn't want to see us. They hate us, but they inspired us to some wonderful things that went on tonight. And the players used to go around and wave to the fans. They got several different responses. Usually the one finger salute came out. But they were playing their part in the formation of the greatest, the most challenging game of football on the planet at that time, and that was the State of Origin matches.
Yeah, I say this quite a lot. You shouldn't underestimate the power of hate.
Mm.
Like what it can bring out in people and what it can inspire that hatred of one another. That rivalry. It really can. And you know what? When talk to a number of people about do you miss the game, and I miss aspects of it. But you know what? I almost miss being hated.
Mm.
Like I'm sure probably some people listen to this like no, we still hate you. But being reminded of that, like going back to take a kick off and people are telling you what they think of you and your family members and
and it just inspires you. It gives you reason.
It's fun it as is. Well it's confronting. It's
and you can see if you come up with something, if you score a try or you get to full time and you catch that person's face again and you put the hand up to the ear, I can't hear anything coming from your mouth at the moment. You'll get the one fingered salutes come out. And, you know, a lot of people see that as the dark side of the game. For me, it's all avenues. Everybody that comes to the game gets to play a role in that match, whether it's, one that's good for PR of footy or not. But we all play a role in it. And for the people that come and play good dollars at the gate to get in and watch, they're pretty much open to doing whatever they want, saying whatever they want. They get to be able to go home at the end of it fairly happy on 50% of the times. And you go disappointed. Mm. But it is the promotion of a game which has taken it to levels in this country which just cannot be matched.
Mm. I think the great thing about our sport in rugby league, the overwhelming majority of the time, it is quite respectful as well, and it doesn't cross that line like we see in, especially where I'm from and the sporting culture around Europe, where it can go way too far and over the line, in my opinion, with that crowd interaction. But I think here in Australia, rugby league is great. They've got the power of hate, but they know where the line is and they tend not to cross it.
When we look at it and try and work out what was good and what was bad, well, we're probably getting a little bit carried away there. It everybody deserves to be able to voice their opinion and play their role, and It just makes it the greatest game of all. And I often get asked questions from the AFL guys that I was around about the same time. They say, does it get to you? Does it put you off? Does it? And I used to smile and think, it's already gained its cause. We've got blokes from other sports that have been watching our sports. They love it, and they talk about the hatred. And we do get to see interstate matches at AFL, Aussie Rules level. But I've got to say, they are nowhere near what rugby league can promote, and certainly the international game. is alive and kicking. And when you get to see the pride that you and I had when we were going out there with our country's colours on, you just feel that is the greatest day of your life. Mm. You get the chance to represent the people and gain some well-deserved honour for that country.
Yeah, you know, as I was talking there about how, like, the fans can be respectful, just the image in my head of that that game where those cans of 4X just getting pelted onto the field. Like, maybe that was a line cross, but what a waste of a beer.
Yeah, yeah. Like, and
because really, if you've got a tin of beer to throw it onto the field, you're going to need some in it. If it's empty, if the can's empty, it's not going to make it to the field.
Yeah.
So.
And it's not just the people in front of that thrower that actually get to be able to play a part in it. They get the grog all over them, the beer all over them. They want to turn around. They want to fight the person that threw it behind. So it's
just what a waste.
Oh, it is.
It's a great product.
Waste of a good product.
Yeah, that's waste it. Of a great product. Yeah. Mate, we probably have skipped ahead a little bit, but we'll see where this all goes. But probably before we get into your marvellous footballing career, you went public with your recent diagnosis. Firstly, how are you with all that, and how's the reaction been?
Yeah, very good. I've probably enjoyed conversation with, I reckon, 20, 25 former footy players, former sports people. That ask me about it. What should I look for? Is this what it really feels like? I've had some issues and go ahead with it. I probably argued with myself for a little while about whether I was going to go public with it. And thankfully, a very long conversation with the doctors brought that out to be a common sense approach. He said, you're not, some people will probably suggest you're seeking sympathy. That's not what it is. You've got an admission of the problem that you're dealing with at the moment. And certainly that started with my bosses at Channel 9, who were terrific. I had to approach them, and it was my boss instantly, Jonathan Upton, the sports boss, where I'd spoken to him, and he said, you seem to be mispronouncing a few more words. And he said, or when we're in general conversation, he said, you say the same thing. Three or four times, and there was one occasion where we went out and I was just doing a Q&A at a rugby league thing with the Broncos, and a couple of the guys turned around and had a bit of a giggle, and I said, if you don't mind me asking, what was the giggle? And they said, oh, nothing. And I found out later that they said, oh, he just asks the same questions time after time. So I enjoy the honesty. If they had come out and said, mate, you kept asking the same thing, I probably would have sought advice on it a little bit earlier. And I've got to admit there are players in my loved sport of rugby league, and certainly from others as well that are dealing with the issues, and ones in everyday life. I think the one issue that I had was that there was one former player who rang me, and he was quite a few years before me, and he said, we've got to put you up front to sue them. We've got to get this. You've got to do this, and you've got to say this, and you have to do this. And I said, mate, let's get one thing straight. I don't got to do anything. If I decide to do it for my own challenges and to answer a few of the questions, I'll be happy. He said, no, but we've got to sue them. They got plenty of money, and we've got to take it. And I said, well, in any issue that I've got, my primary concern is not the financial reward. It's taking to the problem, addressing it, and making sure that I can deal with it in the best way possible. And thankfully, the docs have been very good with that. I'm getting conversations probably every fortnight that I have with them, and certainly that they've offered a short term and a long term plan to go ahead with it and deal with it. And I probably admit it was a little bit of an embarrassment to start with.
It shouldn't be.
No, No, you hit the nail on the head. It shouldn't be. If you're dealing with some of the issues in your life, you've just got to take it on and admit that they have to be approached in the fair and honest way.
Yeah. So with any health news, diagnosis, often you're given advice or ways to combat this and new processes. How has this then, with that advice being given to you, how has this changed your day-to-day approach?
James, I think there was a little bit of a hard swallow to accept it originally. And to probably take a couple of weeks to sit back and think, okay, what's my plan from here? What do I want to do? What would I like to achieve? So that was a careful sit-down process. And I did a bit of a Q&A with my doc, and I was probably asking him questions that he smiled, to which I said, "What is that a funny question?" He said, "No, mate. Everyone asks the same questions. Everyone. You know, how bad will it get? Can I do this? Could I possibly be, you know, one that's going to get worse? Am I going to remember my own children's names?" When you get over that that surprise from the start, I think you take a little bit of a serious approach to it and think, okay, take a deep breath. Again, don't feel sorry for yourself. Just get on with life. Be thankful to the people that are providing support for you, which I am enormously, both at work and in my everyday life. So that's been terrific, and be able to deal with it. And I think that the opportunities that I've had, where I probably kept it all very quiet in the opening moments before going public. I think those guys now will remember me asking plenty of questions about how they felt, what it was like, what to expect. So it's just a case now of me doing almost a Trading Places movie and move on with life in the same way that that they gave me advice to do so.
Yeah. So just with the future, you've got plenty of life to give. What are your plans for the next few years?
To go ahead, I'm sure I'm the same as you. I can't give away footy. I can't get away from rugby league. It's the love of my life, and I probably see that as, in one respect, as being, you know, the only future for me. I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed. A lot of my friends sort of say that you're not the smartest bloke around. So try and make sure that you always stick pretty close to that perimeter of your life that has been so successful, and one that you've walked along for so long. And that is dealing with the public, talking to them. Always stay, you know, very close to them. But more so than anything else, be quite willing to be able to deal with it and take it on. Yes, there is a bit of embarrassment there, but mate, I've embarrassed myself enough in my lifetime to put this aside and realise that there is benefit there in the future for me to enjoy my life, to just get on with it and don't go around, again, to repeat this one, and seek sympathy. I'm not after that. All I want to do is be able to have as good a time as possible, certainly live a similar life than I have for the last few decades, and that's all going to be toweled around rugby league.
Yeah, well, that's great to hear, and it's something that, you know, in my own sort of personal journey as well, I certainly don't want any sympathy for the life that I had, the decisions that I made, but give me some solutions to how I can approach, you know, the next chapter and next decade or 20, 30 years of my life. And even, you know, you speak there about the certain players in the camp of, we're going to sue, or we want financial compensation for this. I don't know if that addresses any of the problems or any of the issues. I think what they need, I say this, they don't need a hand out, they need a hand up. Give these former players a solution, because what's done is done.
Yeah.
Like,
We want to help them in the best way possible and make their future years as comfortable as possible and have plenty of assistance available. Mm. And that's probably the primary objective is to get as much assistance there and to make the players fully aware of who can they turn to. If there isn't somebody that they're happy with the first time around, we'll certainly go on and perhaps meet a second or a third person to be able to get the professional advice, which will create a great future for them.
That's it as well. So for me, there's a void or a lack of awareness about where to go. So even yourself, I've had that where I've had people call me up and I'm like, I don't really know what to say.
Mm.
Yeah, I can give you this doctor's number, but you need a GP to refer you. It's kind of, it's difficult because it's a responsibility to, you know, there's players out there that are suffering or they're concerned that, you know, they've had this life where they played professional sport or played at the top level, and you know, part of that is being involved in a contact sport. Collision sport comes at a cost, but then they call you. There needs to be, in my opinion, a greater pathway for or place or phone, whatever it may be, for those former players to pick up and get the help that they need. Not sign over a class action lawsuit. It's not going to help.
No. Now the support network. Yeah. Is what they're after. Players fully aware, and I think it'd be a good idea from the NRL and certainly players' managers. I've got to say that they're not just there to arrange a few advertising deals and make sure the money's best. They're there for their health, for the players' health and well-being as well, so that they can come forward with some good suggestions and work together with the NRL to be able to plan something out. And I don't think that's so difficult to do if that managers or best friends' thoughts are. But it's just solely on making sure that the health and well-being gets the best advice.
Are you concerned for the future of the game?
Yeah, I am. I think that there will be damage, which certainly will be created for the game, caused for the game. I have no doubt, it's better if I say it this way. I fear that there may be a number of players and perhaps managers that really take the league on and make sure that the game is hammered to get as much as they possibly can for their player or themselves. And I guess in one respect, you certainly can't blame them for taking that action against their health. But for others that are simply scrounging for a little bit of extra cash that they can possibly get for their client or themselves, they've got to remember that they got themselves in that position in the first place by their own choice. It was their decision. They decided that they wanted to go ahead and make as much money as they possibly could from the game. And whilst we never wish discomfort on the players for continuing on, I think they've got to realise that it was my choice in the first place.
Yeah, I think that for me, and again, I'm in a fortunate position that I get access to these doctors, but I take full responsibility for the person that I used to be.
Yeah,
and it's going to come at it's probably going to come at a cost. I take that on board. Could I have been protected from myself at times? I don't know. Did I want to be? Definitely not.
Well, peeing in your pocket, mate. Watching you play, I mean, you took on the toughest opponents every time you were there. You're out there to gain success for your team, whether it be at club or country level. Most of the blokes playing the game, we're all the same. We hate losing. We don't want the embarrassment of defeat attached to us, and we don't want to be seen as somebody that was a coward on the field. We just want to be judged by our teammates and the footy fans as somebody that did their best to ensure that team went as close as possible to success throughout the course of the game. And at the end of it, when we walk away, I think we feel privileged to have played the game, what we keep calling the greatest game of all.
Yeah, I think there can be greater awareness made of some of the potential dangers. And you know some of the protocols in place that I fully support, but I think you know, I'm big on personal responsibility. If someone wants to smoke a cigarette, you know, you go for it, mate. Mm-hmm. Like if someone wants to eat, you know, unhealthily all the time, you know, abuse substances, then, you know, sort of good luck to you. You're aware of the danger here.
Mm.
You know, we shouldn't be pleading ignorance, I think, anymore. Like the current player now should have enough information to make informed choices about if is this the career choice for them. I think, you know, the one thing probably around players of your generation is that the lack of awareness, and maybe perhaps, you know, the worry is if the game's administrators knew what they were doing was potentially dangerous and not informing them, then you know, you've got to look at, you know, should people be made accountable for that. But again, I don't think financial compensation is going to help. I think the care and the services help.
Yeah. I'm sure you and I are hitting the same nail on the head. Financial reward for it, it plays a little bit of a role in that's what the player earned.
Mm.
But we're not seeking to go out and get financial reward for the issues that we're dealing with now.
Yeah.
We just want to be able to be very close to the doctors, I'm sure, and be able to communicate with them to ensure that we get through this the best way possible. Mm. Is there a way to come out? What the options are? What can we do? What should be the first thing that I take on? And if it is something that we feel comfortable with, I think it's something that in our everyday life we're going to feel comfortable with just dealing with that issue time after time after time. I'm sure there's going to be disappointment there. There will be a little bit of embarrassment there, but I don't see it as being something that we'll hold our head in shame over. We played the game that we loved.
And we were young. When people are 18 to 30, yep, you are natural risk takers.
Yeah.
You know, you do some stupid things and like things that you just go like, what was I doing? Like you look back and think, you're embarrassed about, like, even as a teenager, like,
yeah,
man, I used to like muck around near railways, and you're like, what are you doing?
Not a good idea.
Like,
that
what
one.
Are you like? If I saw my kids doing that now, I would read them the absolute riot act.
Yeah, and mate, there's also, you know, an everyday problem. Well, not every day, unless you really do need some help of how often. When we were in the late teen years, when we thought, okay, go out and get on the grog, there'd be a fight break out, and probably 50% of the time you were responsible for it where you shouldn't have been, and you copped a little bit of a pasting in that, and you just see that as an everyday program about growing up, part of the everyday lifestyle where you learnt lessons. And it's the benefit that you get from the answer to those lessons, and how you go on with your everyday life. I think that it is the most important.
I think as well for a lot of people, and I wonder if you're the same, that life was better with rugby league than without it.
Oh.
Even though we might pay a hefty price,
yeah,
it was, yeah, like I look back and reflect and go, oh, it was worth it.
Yeah, and I'm sure you say the same things. You go back and you look at those times where we were representing our club, our state, our country, particularly the country one, by the time you get out there, you think that I've achieved everything I wanted to achieve in life. If I didn't want to be here in the first place, I wouldn't have worked so hard to get here. Now it's something, and if we have some problems that come along, whether it be issues with our memory or having broken bones, and I can remember one guy saying that surely you've broken both bones and he asked me once, he said, when I was asked about what the biggest issue was, he said, I had to learn to wipe my bum with the other hand. That was the greatest challenge in life. And I said, well, I think there's probably greater challenges in footy than that in to deal with it, but it's how you how you enjoy the rest of your life, and are you going to, you know, use some of those injuries as an excuse package? And whilst everyone will probably have a different answer to that, I feel quite comfortable with the life that I've had. And again, to say that same question again, if If I was asked, what would you change? I'd say nothing. You know, you'd like to change some of the results of the games that we had, the embarrassing losses, the thrashings, those sorts of things. But you learn plenty from those in your lifetime.
Yeah, you sort of need to go through those losses, don't you? But would you change perhaps the sort of culture around maybe suffering a head knock and a badge of honour to be earned by continuing on? Obviously, if you were to go back and you were to adopt that approach, you'd stand out and everyone would be like, what's going on here? Mm. But if everybody game-wide, the attitude was, okay, I can clearly see you suffered a concussion or you're knocked out, okay, we're going to rest you for at least a week, 2 weeks, whatever it may be. Do you think if you go back, would you change that? Perhaps.
Well, it'd probably be common sense to do it. But,
yeah.
Mate, to be honest, I think that if I was looking at missing a week with the concussion, I'd be saying to the doc, I was okay. There's nothing wrong. And I reckon 99% of the guys that play rugby league would give the same answer. They'd say, mate, I copped a bit of a bump, but it wasn't too bad. I'm okay.
Yeah. Well, it's funny you say that. I was only looking at some studies a couple of weeks ago that, you know, the number of people that lie or that have that actually admit to lying about being concussed.
Yeah.
Like it's so common. Obviously, we see the players that get knocked out. It's clear, but there are a number of concussions that go undiagnosed because players don't want to be honest.
Yeah,
and you know, I think that's a big part of the education piece around, like, okay, guys, like, we're not going to be able to pick the doctors, the medical staff. They're not going to be able to pick everything up, but you got to be honest with yourself and honest with your doctors, and you might end up paying a price for this later down the track.
Mm.
But it's a space that keeps on advancing, and I think until we can get, because it's hard to know even what a concussion is. It's hard to describe.
Yeah.
And it means different things to different people.
Mm.
And the consequences are different for different people as well.
Mm.
And
I've got to say that, I mean, you face the probability of a serious neck. Front rowers, so different players in the game, you see. we used to have a thing where we said that those wingers out there, they're imposters. They basically never get the ball from the kickoff. It's just the fullback catches it, or the halfback, he turns around. Who's running onto the ball? A front rower.
Yeah.
Maybe a second rower sometimes. You're charging into the defence and you can just see that they're thinking, well, we're going to fix him up first tackle of the game. Here we go. How are you going to hit him? Do we just target his knees? Do we just try and hit him right under the rib cage, or should it be a shoulder charge, which will increase the probability? And most of the time, we used to see that, where players would run in, there'd be a shoulder charge, the first tackle of the game.
Yeah, great way to kick. Well, it was the way to start a game, wasn't it?
Well, I'm glad I wasn't a front rower like you were. Wow. I took the coward's way out as captain. Hit it up, boys.
Yeah, go on, get us forward. Mate, you spoke some time there about broken bones. So I watched a video recently about you talking about your time with the tax man and the tax officer, and he was saying, like, well, you've earned this money, I'm going to take 40%, and you're like, yes, you're right, I did earn this because I've broken my nose 6 times,
yeah.
I've broken hands, arms, whatever it is, I'll give you 2/3 of that as well. Can you talk?
Yeah.
Is this actually happening with an actual tax officer?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, I went in with my accountant. He sat in there and he said, just let me talk. Don't get too carried away.
I don't understand why. Yeah.
And I reckon after about 2 or 3 minutes, I said, are you looking after me or are you looking after him? I said, you're my tax officer. I said, I look after you. You're my accountant. I look after you. We talk about this all the time. And I could see him sort of saying, oh, but just settle down. Just if we just let him talk. And I said, yeah, we've already started on that. And the guy started saying, well, you know, you deserve that. Everybody, the hardworking man in the street, he does this. And I said, okay, well, if you're taking 2/3 of everything I've got for my 6 broken noses, what about I break yours 4 times? And that can be a grip. And he stood up and he said, oh. And there was another gentleman that was also sitting in the room. He was in the corner. He hadn't said a word from the moment that we went in there, and he stood up and he said, oh, if we can just hover. And I said, and who are you? And he said, well, I'm the man that's in charge of this. And I thought, oh, right, he looks like he's a little bit older than this guy here. And he just said, if we can just take a bit of a break. And I thought, how long have we been going? 5 minutes we've been sitting in here. So that all started a little bit of a different beginning to stage two, which we went outside and settled down for a while, had a cup of coffee, you know, just settled down, mate. My accountant said, oh, you know, mate, don't go so, you know, aggressive. And I said, well, he's taken that, yet, you know, you're not standing up for me. And I had to go, and he said, let it go. When we went back in the second time, to their credit, the man that was in the corner of the room to start with, he actually took over the seat. And another gentleman came and sat in the corner and said, let's go from here. And I found that to be far more acceptable. So did my accountant, although he said, but the end result, he said, we're not going to know for a little while yet, but if you can just sort of remember, you don't want to be upsetting them. And I said, I know I should, you know, shot my mouth off, but if they're taking 2/3 of everything else, they don't have any respect for the pain that players go through. And that's all players in all sports. Mm. So that was something that I found very difficult to deal with.
Mm. Well, hopefully you didn't break the tax officer's nose in the end. That probably wouldn't have gone down too well. Mate, the legacy of Wally Lewis, the legend, the immortal. Again, for me coming over to this country, obviously, and an understanding of who you are, the overwhelming majority is around the Queensland legend, the Australian representative legend. And then I was thinking, well, Wally Lewis's club, like, it very, very seldom gets mentioned. Can you tell us a little bit? And then, because... backpedal a little bit, I did some research. You're playing for Fortitude Valley, not far from where we are in these very studios. Pardon the ignorance, because and I guess a lot of our younger fans and listeners wouldn't be able to understand, because all they've ever known is the NRL. And that's what was that Queensland competition like?
Well, it was the Brisbane Rugby League comp, as it was in those days. That club, Fortitude Valley, known as the Diehards, that was a club that I went to in under 13s, went over there basically because my club side, a lot of the young guys that were playing found other things in life that they wanted to do and go around, and the club fell apart. So I went to the Valleys. I'd played in the Queensland Primary Schools rugby league team, and there was a couple of guys in that their team, two of them, Mark Duke and Colin Edwards, there you go, my memory's working, played for Valleys, and were exceptional players. And where my dad was working, in the education department, supplying stores, was not far from where the Valleys Juniors field is. So he used to just say, if you've got one of those guys and you're going to school with them now, why not just travel back with them whenever they're playing, and I can pick you up after work. It's 5 minutes away for me. So it fitted the whole family. And I think I got to experience a little bit of the love for a club. I still say it is the club that I enjoyed playing for. More than ever, we still get together every year on grand final weekend, the Friday night prior to the grand final. The boys all get together, sing the old club song, and they were somewhere that really taught me about the game itself. The coach was Johnny Rhodes. He played at centre for Australia in the Test series. And was a spectacular player, but the captain was Ross Strudwick, and he later took over as captain coach and then singularly the coach. And I often used to say that he taught me more about footy and life in general than anybody else, certainly, other than my dad had in that period as I sort of approached what the big time was going to be about. He was very clever with his ability to be able to run the ball and create doubt in the opposition defence, and he always used to teach me or talk to me about what it was to read the play. He said, you know what this, and I said, I hear everyone talking about it, and he said, it's about numbers. If you've got an advantage in numbers, if you've got five attackers on one side and they've only got three defenders on the short side, well, that's what it's all about. And I found myself starting to assess the game pretty much, and I'd asked my dad about it, and he said, yeah, look, that's an interest for me too, he said, but if you've got that, you've either got that or you haven't. You can pretend that you want to learn about it, and which I did, but I used to get told that I read the play pretty well, and it was from that moment that I went on to be able to, I had my favourite line. It was about when you're attacking somebody and you're trying to come up with a break in the opposition's defence, you get your main ball player to create doubt in the mind of the defender all the time. And if you can see that that they don't know whether to go in to make the tackle, hang back, look and sort of say, hang on, it's going to go to the bloke outside, maybe the bloke inside. As soon as you got him in with his mind in a world of doubt, you've got him beaten. It's just a matter of time. It mightn't happen in that ruck, but it'll happen the one after that or the one after that, and there'll be times where you can just work a way at it. And yeah, have a look at the good ball players in the current day games, and they all display this with almost monotonous regularity. When we had the big days of Cam Smith doing it, and when they had that Melbourne side, I think I used to love sort of sitting back and seeing they had Cooper Cronk that also did it, and to see them do it, you get to appreciate the talents of the other people, and you find yourself in a conversation where you like to talk about it and who taught it to you, and when did you first come about it, and it's quite interesting. It can be a little bit different for some players and the way that they have it, but it is something that you can't take too much credit for, because it exists in the game. It's just a matter of whether you pick it up and run with it.
It's horrible being on the other end of that, by the way, when you're middle forward and you're fatigued, and then you've got someone deceptive, and you don't know if they're coming, they're going, they're going to get the ball, they're not, they're going to step, they're going to try and run past you, run through you, pass, short ball. It's a horrible feeling to be on the end of that, mate. So,
And I watched the young guys like today, like Cleary, when he was doing that for Penrith, to see the way that he does it, and he targets the big boys. And a lot of the big boys say just that, well, if you run this way again, we're going to fix you up, fella. Make a decision.
When you're fresh, do it when you're fresh, please. Take us on when you're fresh. Mate, just onto the Fortitude Valley and the club side, like, can you talk to us about the standard of that Brisbane competition and how it may be compared with the Sydney comp? Was the quality of player still the same, but it's just that there was more financial reward in that Sydney competition?
Well, the financial reward of the Sydney comp was why the standard of the competition here wasn't as good as what it had been. If the good players were at standout level, they'd be picked up by the Sydney clubs. They certainly were. The guy that was playing at Valleys prior to me going there was John Rebo, and he got picked up by the Western Suburbs club in Sydney, played for a couple of clubs down there. He ended up playing on the wing because he was so fast, but it was the necessity for the Sydney clubs to further boost their talent. And for me, it was a challenge, and I loved the opportunity. But I was a kid that dreamed about it. I thought you had to be superhuman to make first grade, and particularly when you were doing it at the Sydney competition, where I used to watch them with my father every week. We used to get the one game where we'd sit there, and Dad used to talk about the players, the special players, what they do, how they do it, and to look for this when you play, and you should try and do this. And I used to sit back and just listen to him talk about it all the time. And we got told year after year after year that to make first grade in Sydney, you might make it in Brisbane and play in that bum competition up there. You've got to be superhuman to play in the Sydney competition. And we probably felt that we weren't as good as what they were. And then the big question was, am I going to have somebody that's a talent scout? from a Sydney club? Are they going to come here and pick me? Year one for me, it happened. It was North Sydney I got an offer from, but it was only from a guy from the North's club here in Brisbane that said, I'm going to send a couple of my players down there. Do you want to go down and play for North Sydney? My dad said, you don't want to play for North Sydney. North Sydney's not your club. And I said, but what about the money they're offering? That's lots more money. He said, no, just hold back. And I think the respect that I had in judgment for my father was at an all-time high, you know, and I probably thought that he's my greatest advisor. He was coaching first grade in Brisbane and, you know, sort of talking about the things I should do and shouldn't do on the field. So it was certainly very beneficial to have him. I didn't agree with everything that he said, but certainly most of the advice that he gave me really did turn out to be a positive fact for me if I was going to go to bigger and better things in the game.
Yeah, well, you certainly did achieve a few big things in the game. But on that move, or those moves that never eventuated, going to Sydney, just how close did it ever come?
Yeah, well, funnily, just before this talk with you, I've been sitting in the office with Gene Miles, and he found an old program and also another paper and a press article that was talking about us going down, and we were gone. We'd been playing in Brisbane for a couple of years. I left my beloved club Valleys to go to Winner Manly because Valleys, the club president, Dr. Tom Dooley, said, mate, we can't pay you. We can't pay you for last year yet. We're gonna pay you, but we can't afford to give you this money. I was on $13,000 a year, which I regarded as the unlucky number. I'm not going to get that. And he said, look, he said, I promise you, he said, if it's to the day I die, we will pay you that money. I said, what club? I got an offer from Wynnum, which was basically double that. And I said, well, I'm coming down there. It was where my dad had his coaching career, and I thought, that'll do me. I'll head down there. I went down, played in that Wynnum team, and I still regard the 1984 Wynnum side as the hottest team I ever played in. They were unbelievable. Desi Morris was the coach, and Rod Morris had played there 2 years prior to that, and Wynnum won their first ever premiership in the history of the club. So it was an opportunity to go down there and play with some handy players. In the back line, there was Gino, Brett French, who was playing State of Origin, Colin Scott, who played State of Origin, Terry Butler also played State of Origin. So I thought, I can't do too bad here. Greg Dowling was in the front row, so I thought, well, this looks like the place to me. And Desi Morris's coach, he basically just said, if we've got talented attacking players, why stop them? He said, try and cut their errors a little bit, not to make so many. And we played South in the grand final, who were coached by Wayne Bennett, and they had Mal and a whole pile of blokes in it. And we beat them 42-8. And to be honest, we should have beaten them by another 20. We were throwing the ball around and guys were laughing and giggling. And, you know, we were being a bit disrespectful for South in the end, just trying to make sure that, you know, the blokes that didn't get to score tries, like the front rowers or the second, that they got to enjoy one. And that was honestly, it was as good an attacking side as I ever played in. They were remarkable.
Do you think it doesn't get enough credit?
The Brisbane Rugby League comp? Yeah, I do. But it was all the time, of course, Sydney got all of the credit, and they deserve so. And that was insisted that they got all the credit because in the years in the build-up to that, in the decades to that, they'd have some of the best Brisbane teams would be up against the or which formed into a Queensland team, would play against New South Wales and we'd get flogged. They'd say, oh, geez, that's their best team. They can't get within 20 points of us, 30 points of us. So that was the disrespect that was cast towards the Brisbane Rugby League competition. And should we have had it? Well, it's probably not a nice promotion for the game, and it is a bit of an insult, but we could not match the competition. And when it was Queensland versus New South Wales, very rarely did Queensland win. We'd go along there, and I can remember my dad quite often used to say, I hope we score a try tonight, hope we get a try. So that was his great love, if Queensland scored. And every now and then they'd chalk up a win, and it was almost a public holiday here for a couple of days. So to have that basically develop into at the end of that, where the last year I played was 87, and all talk then was about we've got to get this team in. And it was granted. The Brisbane Broncos were created, and then we had the opportunity to go and try and prove ourselves, that we've always claimed that if we get a team playing in the Sydney comp, we'll be more than competitive, we'll be able to win a premiership. That took a little while to come about, 5 years, but certainly we finally had the honour of playing in the best competition in the game.
Yeah, you speak there about not going down to Sydney. Is there a story there where you and Gene Miles
I'm sure most people agree. I've heard it, but we got to the stage in 1987, and it was after just finding out that Wynnum couldn't pay us for 86 season. I said, we've been here in 1984, 85, 86, and we keep hearing this. Unfortunately, we can't pay at the moment. We'll pay you in the middle of next year. As soon as this financial year's over, we'll pay you for the next one. And we'd had enough. And we'd watched a number of players go and play in the Sydney comp, doing very well and getting huge payments whilst they were playing there. And we approached our legal representatives, and it was all about, we can't stay here anymore. We've got to go and play in Sydney. So to get into the story, we were basically told that there was a Sydney club interested in making an offer to us. We asked who the Sydney club was. We were told, can't tell you that. It's a complete secret. They've asked for this to be kept silent. And I said to Gene, who do you reckon it is? I reckon it's got to be East. And he said, oh, yeah, they buy plenty of Queensland blokes, you know. Over the years, they've had plenty. He said, I reckon it might be Manly. I said, oh, I don't know about that. But, you know, do you reckon it might be some of the others? He said, Norths were still around at that stage. And he said, they buy a lot of people. I don't know. So we stuck together pretty solid. And then it came to the stage where we were told that if you want to talk about next year, we've got to talk to you about next year. Let's have a meeting. And I said, who's the club? And they had to, in those days, apply for permission to negotiate with the said players. So the Queensland Rugby League rang us and they said, we've had a Sydney club ring us and apply for permission to negotiate with you and another player. And I said, who's the other player? And he said, well, we can't mention him. And I said, well, what club? You're allowed to mention the club. And they said, same club, Wynnum Manly. I said, it's Gene Miles. They said, well, we can't tell you. And I said, okay, righto. Sat back, when is all this going to take place? And I said, well, if you want to come in here, that was on a Monday. On a Wednesday, we went in, had a bit of a discussion, and we were told that, yes, okay, we are going to apply for the permission. We did that. Everything was okay. Came back in the next day and then said, well, here we go, righto. I know who it is. And they said, well, how do you know who that other player is? And I said, because I told Gino that I had an approach and he told me that he'd had an approach. So it is him. And they said, well, yes, it is. It went forward to there where we were told that, okay, you can go to Sydney. Okay, well, yes, we can go to Sydney. We've got the permission to do that. We'll go ahead. Yep, righto. So we arrived at the old Brisbane airport and we were waiting for some sort of car to pull up with the representative from the club. And I thought, yep, who do you reckon it'll be? You know, and I said, I reckon it might be this guy that used to do a little bit of work for Norths here in Brisbane. And he used to talk to some of the Sydney clubs. And the next thing, this plane pulled in and Gino said, Jesus, making a bit of noise. We can't hear each other. And the pilot walked over and said, Mr. Lewis, Mr. Miles. Yes, and he said, if you can walk this way, please. Where are we going? He said, to Sydney. I'm told I've fly two passengers, a Lewis and a Miles, to Sydney. Christ, Gino said, got to ask for more money now. Got to ask for more money. We're flying to Sydney. And we're having a look at it, and it's this jet. We're getting into a jet. And he said, who do you reckon this is? And I said, oh, it can only be two clubs. Maybe three. North Sydney used to throw around a lot of money. Said, I reckon it's East. And he said, I reckon it might be Manly. I said, oh, it could be, but, you know, East, they didn't sort of have too good a season, you know, in the last few, and they're missing players. Okay, and this pilot said, if you don't mind, we'll get in the plane. I said, right, and we got in there, and we're flying along. And he's, and I've heard this, psst, what? And he said, how much we can ask for? And I said, oh, well, they've got to make us an offer. And he said, yeah, but how much do we want? How much, you know? I said, oh, well, they reckon Price and Cronin are on 90 grand in Sydney, I reckon, at Parramatta, so I reckon, what, if we ask for 75? And he went, yeah, okay. Sat back in the plane, getting comfortable. 5 minutes later, psst, what are you doing this psst for? And he said, well, you never know. I said, oh, you think the plane has got microphones in it, where it's bugged. And I said, you're an idiot. And he said, oh, no, just keep it quiet. How much are we going to ask for? And I said, well, I told you that, you know, we'll ask for 70, 75 grand. He said, yeah, but is that you getting 70 or 75, or is that me getting 70 or 75? And I said, it's both of us. And he said, shake hands on that. And I went, what? Don't you trust me? He said, not one bit. Not one bit. I said, you're my best mate. And he said, which is why I don't trust you one bit. And we were flying. And I said, well, what about we ask for, you know, we'll ask for, we'll bump the money up a little bit from there. And he said, okay. We landed at the other end. We walked out and we're standing around waiting. A guy walked over to us. He was dressed in the suit, tie, and I said, Mr. Lewis, Mr. Miles? Yes. Said, I've come here to join you, to pick you up and drive you. I said, where are we going? What club are we with? And he said, sir, I'm only a driver. I've been told to pick up two passengers from here. And I thought, oh, Jesus, what are we doing? Gino said, oh, well, you know, this is what we're going to ask for, you know, that money. And he said, I still reckon we're at East, Manly. And I said, I reckon we're at East. And we started to head towards Bondi. And I said, oh, we're going there for sure. This is... We missed the turn and we went on towards the bridge and I went, oh, we're going to Manly. Must be going to Manly. And then he turned off the bridge and went into the city and I said, we might be going to North Sydney, but that's on the other side of the bridge. And all of a sudden I went, oh, shit. Oh, look, PBL Marketing Limited. That's Gary Packer. And Gina said, got to ask for more money now. More money. He said, we'll bump it up. I said, all right, yeah, okay, yeah, we'll bump it up. And to cut a long story short, we got out, we're welcomed, put in the lift, taken upstairs. We got upstairs and here was Bob Fulton and Doug Daly, the Manly coach and secretary. They were sort of waiting around. They came out of Packer's office. They sat there. We went in, walked in, and Mr. Packer was sitting there, sitting back, having sucking a cigarette. And we walked in. He said, so you're the two C's causing us all the trouble. Hurry up and sign that. And I got the nudge from Gino under the table. Here, you do the talking. He's a pretty quiet sort of a bloke. And I said, oh, well, Mr. Packer, you've got to make us an offer first, and then we take it home to the Queen. He said, son, pull up. He said, let's get one thing straight. I don't got to do anything. If you want to come down here and play football, I'll make you. And I said, well, no, okay. And he said, so how much is it going to cost? And I said, well, you really do, you're required to make this offer to us, which we'll take home to the Queensland Rugby League, give them the chance to try to match that contract. If they can match it, then we have to stay there straight away. If they can't match it, then we get the chance to come down here to Sydney. He said, well, son, let's get another thing straight. If I make you an offer, those C's from up there, they're no chance of matching it. And I'm trying to swallow hard. And I said, no, I don't. And I'm looking for Gino for a bit of advice. And one, we hadn't said a word. And he said, if you want to sign those. And I said, well... if Gene and I, he's not giving me any support. I said, so you've got to make us an offer. And got her. And I said, you're required to make an offer to us, Mr. Packer, and we'll take that. And he said, okay. He said, well, let's get this over and done with. And he said to Doug Daly, we'll do this one at a time. And Daly, sure, he said. He walked out and he said, okay, we'll do this. And Gino nearly tore a hamstring getting out of the chair, racing outside. And I thought, oh, Christ. I'm going in with Kerry Packer first, and I'm sitting there. I could feel myself shaking. He said, son, I've got a few things on today, so if you don't mind, we'll get through these a little bit quicker. I thought, he's probably dealing with something in mega millions and trillions that he's talking about, and here's two mug footballers. And I looked at him, and I said, all right, Mr. Packer. He said, if you want me to come and play for the Manly Warringah District Rugby League Football Club Limited for seasons next and the one after. He said, son, just give me the money. How much do you want? And I said, all right. And I'm thinking, oh, well, it said 70, 75, grand, 70, 75. See, if you want me to play for the Manly Warringah District Rugby League Football Club, you're going to have to give me 100. And $50,000 a season. And the voice went all squeaky, and he looked at me and said, how much? And I went, $150,000 a season. And he said, for you, you're an arrogant chap, aren't you? And I said, yeah, I am. He said, then you want 150 grand. And I said, well, that's what you've sort of asked me, and I'm telling you. And he said, you're a greedy bastard, and you're arrogant. And I said, yeah, but I've come here to win a premiership for Manly. And just looked at him, and he stopped, and he just raised his eyebrow and went, right, oh, well, you're easy. Get out and get the next bloke in. And I thought, oh, shit, I've got 150 grand. I've never had that much money in my life. Oh, and he said, get up and get the next bloke in. And I thought, yes, Mr. Packer. I said, if you don't mind, I'll sign that contract now. He just looked at me, and I've signed it, and I've got up to walk out. I thought, oh, my best mate, I've just stabbed him in the back. He said, hang on, hey, whoa. Actually, you sit down. You're not going out there to tell him how much you're getting. You sit down. I thought, oh, shit. Oh. Oh, no, Gino's going to come in here, say 70 grand. I'm on more than double that. Oh, no, I can't look at him. And he came in the office, and I didn't look at Gene. And then I looked at Packer, and Packer sort of was looking down, and on the phone he was scribbling something down. I looked at Gene. I went, and he went, what? I thought, you idiot. I got outside, and I put my head down and got out. Bob Fulton and Doug Daly said, welcome to Manly. And I said, well, thank you very much. How do you know I've agreed? They said, no one ever beats him. You know, everybody always agrees to his terms. And I said, yeah, that's right. Got called back in 30 seconds later. I thought, oh, I've just stabbed my best friend in the back. I could not look at him. Doug Daly came in. Fulton came in. They were sitting there and said, yeah, we're going to do this. How's the press release going to be? What are they going to do? And they said, yeah, actually, we haven't filled in the details of the contracts yet. Miles, I said, oh, God, no. Then he's going to tell him how much I'm on. He said, Lewis is on $150,000 a year. And I just cringed, put the head down like that. And I said, and Miles is on $120,000 a year. And I've turned straight round to look at him. And I'm thinking, you're worrying about me being on 70 grand. You've gone straight 120. And he was looking out the window at Sydney Harbour and just trying to make sure that I wasn't embarrassed. And he said, actually, you're a better player than that. You can have another 10. You can be on 130, 135. And Gino's head just nodded forward like that. And Doug Daly was the only thing that sort of stopped that going ahead immediately. He said, Mr. Packer, he said, we can't pay these two that much money and let this become public knowledge. The rest of the Manly players will all want that much money. And he said, okay, how do you want to do this? And he said, well, if PPL Marketing Limited could pay $75,000 and you could employ them for a day, a week, a month, whatever. And Packer said, okay, I'll do that. And if they turn up for the first day's work, I'll give them that check. And Gene tried to be funny. He said, oh, I can't get a week's work, Kerry, eh? Saying that he's going to be on so many thousand a day. And Packer just looked at him, you know, and Gene put the head dead down. I was like, oh, you idiot. And that was the only thing, actually.
A little bit of rugby league humour, though, mate.
Oh, yeah. That was the only thing that really stopped us from going from Manly. The contract for the Manly club was $75,000. We went home and said to the Queensland Rugby League, there it is. You know, I'm getting 150. He's on 135. That's the problem you got to deal with. We came back in the next day, met Ross Livermore and Ron McAuliffe, who was hiding outside, then came in, and he said, we've decided to match these contracts. And I said, you're paying us the same money to play here in Queensland. Said, yeah, we can't let yous go. There's too many players escaping from Queensland. We can't do it. And then I heard Gene say, wait a minute, wait. This contract here's got $75,000 on it. And I turned around and I've looked at McAuliffe and Livermore, and he said, yes, well, that's all we had to match. The Manly Warringah District Rugby League Football Club limit. And I said, no, that's not it. I said, it's $150,000. And he said, well, it's got on here that it's $75,000. I said, yeah, but then they were going to pay us. They were just a bit worried about if the other players found out how much we were getting paid, they'd revolt. So they put that there, and he said, well, unfortunately, that's not all. And I said, oh, well, and Gino got really angry. He said, we'll go back to Sydney. They can put it on the one contract, and if they, you know, if the public find out about it, well, then fine. They're going to have to put up with that. And McAuliffe turned around. He said, permission to negotiate has just been rescinded, gentlemen. And we had it for 24 hours and to go down there and do it. And that was the time that, the only time that we're ever furious and extremely angry with the Queensland Rugby League and Ron McAuliffe. He was always a fantastic fella who was good for the Queensland Rugby League, but he openly said, we're here to make sure. So we ended up signing the contract. It was for $75,000, and then $37,500 of that was from the QRL. $37,500 was from the Winner Manly District Rugby League Football Club. We played that year, and again, they didn't have a cent in the bank, so we actually stayed there for $37,500, way short of what we could have got in Sydney.
Yeah, way short. It's quite the story, though. It's hard. It's hard to imagine that now, just because it was so different back then compared to what it is these days. And obviously the money that goes in, but it's just all under the one competition. Yeah. Obviously we have the Super League competition as well, but
James, if there was one rescue, it was the Broncos came about 12 months later. We got the chance to stay in Brisbane. I was on, I think it was 130,000 a season, and Gino was on 120, and we both said, you know, we could have got more money in Sydney. And I said, yeah, but we're here with our home, family, friends. We didn't have to move out of the city, and we're going to get judged as how we go for the Broncos, not if Manly don't win a game. And I said, they hate us enough at Origin time. If we play for Manly, we're going to get stoned every week.
Yeah.
We have people throwing rocks at us. So in one respect, it was a disappointment that we didn't get to see how we could have gone at Manly. And at the end of that 1987 year, I watched the grand final, Manly won. And Fatty, I rang him to congratulate him, and he said, well, it just goes to prove we didn't need you two pricks anyway, which was a smiling point, but it was a wonderful time for Paul's career.
We're going to take a quick break from this podcast to talk to you about AG1. Now, this is a product I've been taking for over a year now, and I absolutely love it. It gives me all of my daily nutritional needs in one easy drink. All you have to do is put in one scoop of AG1 into a nice cold glass of water, and you are set for the rest of the day. The cupboard has been cleaned out of tablets and powders because all my needs are met by AG1. The power of routine cannot be underestimated, and we all know how small habits lead to big wins. Some of those big wins for me have included better gut health. My clarity, especially in the afternoon, has improved so much. Gone as the mid-afternoon slump. AG1 is a foundational nutritional supplement. Now, as humans, we all share that same basic foundational needs. That's where AG1 take care of everything. This supports your body's needs like nutrient replenishment, gut optimization, stress management, and immune support. AG1 is the supplement I trust to provide the support my body needs daily. And that's why they've been a partner and I've been a user for so long. If you want to take ownership of your health, it starts with AG1. A buy round exclusive. If you try AG1, you get a free 1-year supply of vitamin D3, K2, and 5 free AG1 travel packs with your first purchase. Go to drinkag1.com/buy round. That's drinkag1.com/buy round for our exclusive Australia wide offer. Check it out.
It always fascinates me about like the players' approach in the week. You're a guy of routine. You looked at mindset. How did you approach a game of football?
Yeah, I used to make sure that Tuesdays, the early days, were all about being honest about the mistakes that I'd made in the previous performance, both individually, and also how the team performed, what we could have done a little bit better, and certainly in those early years for the Broncos, there was a few of those that came about. We had a few wins in a row, and everyone started to predict it was great days ahead for the Broncos, but that wasn't the case for me. I'm sure you're the same. All first grade football is pretty much a hard markers. We like to admit that we did something enormously wrong, which could have benefited our teams had we have got them right. And certainly the years playing under Wayne Bennett for me were a little bit of a learning curve. I always used to find that his early days he had a little bit of a different pattern of play. It was about the no mistake type footy and being careful, and for me it was a little bit more about if you out attack somebody, they're never going to beat you. They'll never ever do. You can sort of look after your defence a little bit, and I tried to keep that in, but always had the sort of reminder that it wasn't working. It didn't work at the Broncos. And when I got the chance at the end of my second year there, when I got called in by Bennett, and he said, I'm going to play you at lock next year. And I said, lock? Why is that? And he said, and Gino in the second row sometimes. That changed things, and it turned out to be pretty good. And he said, one other thing he said, I've haven't told you yet. So I sat back down on my way out of the office, and he said, I'm taking the captaincy off you. And there was total silence for about 30, 40 seconds. And he said, what, you're not going to say anything? And I said, is it going to change your decision? And he said, well, no. No, it's not. And I said, and I'd probably like some sort of explanation as to why that is. And he just said, well, you're away for so many of the Origin matches, the representative games. We're going to have a pile of those next year. There's a tour to New Zealand that'll be going on. And he just came forward with all of the ideas that were behind his decision. And I just said, well, he said, and I haven't come up with the decision on who the captain's going to be. And I said, well, we've got two players that don't play representative football. Good luck. I said, that's fine, Wayne. I've got to accept your decision. And I didn't like it. And then about a week later, I got involved in a bit of a conversation. I think it was about that long, where I got called aside by Gino. And he said something about he didn't know whether he wanted to play rep footy anymore. And I said, mate, you don't want to play rep footy? I said, you've always loved it. And there was a bit of an issue between us from then. I was shitty about it. I wanted every team that I was playing in to have Gino in it. He made me look like I was a bit much better player. Fantastic guy in the centres, and to have at representative level him and Mal in the centres, that was something quite extraordinary. So it was a case, and then Gene said, no, he said, I've been thinking about giving the rep footy away. And I said, that's a load of horseshit. You've never wanted to give footy away. You've said that before, previously, and then he kept coming to me, and I snapped a bit, and I said, look, if you want the captaincy, you take it. You take it. If you're that desperate to have a C beside your name, I can give them another reason to have you'll have a C beside your name. And he sort of took it pretty hard, which I guess was no. And I think I've thought back on that hundreds of times, and the mistake I made. I should have just accepted it was a position that he was offered. And he basically thought that it was going to be a good year or a better challenge, a better place to be at the Broncos with him in charge. And he did well. And the next year was disastrous anyway. I broke my arm sort of halfway through the year and didn't get the chance to come back. Then there were a couple of times where I said to Wayne, I'm right to play. We had injuries all over the place. And he said, no, you haven't been cleared by the doctor yet. And I said, I'm telling you, I'm right to play. I wouldn't play if that was the case. We got to the preliminary final and we got smashed in that game. We were getting hammered and I was on the reserves bench. It was my first game back and I was on the reserves bench, I think, until 10 minutes to go in the game. And I can remember sitting there thinking, all right, we're getting belted here. I'd like to think that he'll bring me on to try and inspire the players, to try and, you know, get them to get rid of the losing attitude that we seem to have at the moment. And then I thought, bugger this. What's 6 minutes to go? I'm just going to walk into the dressing shed and get dressed and keep going. My time's finished here anyway. And then he said, you can, I got the message from the trainer, Kelvin Giles. He said, Wayne said, you can go on now. And I said, oh, did he? Thank you very much. And I got on the field and there was nothing about it. And I hung around the next day because the medical was on for the Australian team, where I had to prove myself, sorry. The medical for the Australian team wasn't on until the week after the grand final, or the day after the grand final. But for some reason, I was told I had to have my medical the day after the preliminary final, and I was the only one to have the medical. And I remember my dad said, you know what this means, don't you? You know what's about to happen. They're going to fail you on the medical. And I said, yeah. And there's many stories have been told about that. I got the chance to go and have the medical. I went in there and I basically had the wrong arm, showed the wrong arm and had the, you know, about that and said, no, your arm, your fitness isn't there. You can't do it. And I said, oh, okay, on that arm. I said, yeah, that's the one that needs to be x-rayed. Oh. I said, that's the one that... I said, they're identical spots. And I got the comment back later that, yeah, we knew that. We knew you were going to get the wrong arm x-rayed. We knew that that wasn't the case. And the doc was a former player himself, Nathan Gibbs. He was a good fella. And I've never had the chance to apologise to Nathan for it. I mean, he was in a position where he was basically just... asked to make a decision and he was told by the specialists that my x-ray, it was quite obvious that it had not fully repaired. So I missed out on captaining the second Australian team and going on my second kangaroo tour. No one had captained two kangaroo tours since the early days where it was Churchill, I think, or someone like that. So, It wasn't my favourite period in my life, but I had to learn quite a few things, and some of them were don't be a sook. And there's many players that comfortably took over the position of the team that you had. You didn't take them for yourself.
Yeah, Matt, on playing that representative football, Queensland, Australia. Did you change your approach? Did things change on when you put that jersey on or in the build-up? Because, like I say, some of the performances were absolutely phenomenal. Mm.
Oh, I loved it. Loved the chance to get out there. And I thought that you're performing at the highest level.
So because of the pedestal that it was on, you felt like you needed to raise, or did you play your normal game and then it just happened?
Oh, I thought that I did raise. I played my best footy at representative levels, and people used to ask, why do you do that? How do you do that? And I said, well, the class of the players that you're playing against certainly is raised, but also a lot of people forget the class of player I'm playing alongside in my own team certainly helps make me look a lot better than, you know, the performances I had at that club level. And I'm sure you say that, James. When you're playing with the world's best players, it makes you feel 10 foot tall and bulletproof. It makes you perform so much better and are able to do that quite consistently. And some of the games that I had, certainly while I was playing for Australia, made me feel at the end of it like there wasn't too much else in life that I wanted to achieve.
Yeah, but... But it was just that the standard of your teammates went up. But it just fascinates me how the level of performance you consistently put on, especially in playing for Queensland as well. It's phenomenal because you see a lot of it the other way around now. Like, you know, Nathan Cleary, and who is on such an amazing trajectory and had such an amazing career, he's able to dominate the club. But then, you know, I don't necessarily fully agree, but some of the so-called experts say, well, he doesn't dominate Origin like players like Johns did, like Thurston did, like yourself did. But yeah, is there any more you could add to, like, why when you put that Queensland shirt on, why when you put that Australian jersey on, you went to another level? With it tapped into something?
Yeah, well, having watched you play when you're in the in Great Britain colours or England colours, you know you're playing at the highest level possible. You've got the greatest honour in the game to be captain of Australia. Also. Made me believe that there was a fair IOU that I had and to be able to do it. And when you're working off some of the greatest players in the game that are feeding you the ball, that are timing you the pass, giving it to you when you want it, not early, and have some problems. And you've also got the ability to, I used to look outside me and think, have a look at this. I've got Gene Miles, Mal Meninga, Brett Kenny at one stage where Bert was out there. And it was absolutely impossible. And I used to say, when you play at international level, you're almost defending one-on-one, because the guy that was standing outside me, he wasn't thinking about coming in to look after me. He was thinking about looking at the guy he had in front of him, whether that be Mal or Gino or Brett Kenny. So they couldn't afford to come in and leave them open. So it's one of respect, I think, that when you're up against the finest players in the world, you've got to play to the best of your ability and play your finest game if you want to be in that game and a fair chance of winning it.
You know, when you're playing for your country, Australia, obviously a huge rivalry between Queensland and New South Wales, you know, the some of the blues that went on back in your day. How was the connection, the camaraderie in camp? Was it forgotten about, or was there a little bit of a split?
I think I know which one you're bringing up here. There was a time, 1985, Queensland, New South Wales won the series for the first time, and we took to it like a bunch of sooks. The Queenslanders didn't take to it well at all. Terry Fernley was the coach. And it was something that I had some issues. The first couple of conversations I had with Terry were very different. He has the right to be his own person. I don't know whether I accepted that too much. I'd sort of say, how do you think these guys looked? You're trying to settle on a test team, I know that, and he'd say, looks fine, done good in last game, fair performer, and walk off. And I'd go, I'm not wiser at all. I asked him a question, I could, and I said to Wayne Pearce at one stage, and he said, oh, mate, he's like that, but you've just got to deliver him your answer. Don't answer him the way that he's talking to you. So it did take me a little while, and there was a blow up in the Australian camp at that time. We were in New Zealand, and it wasn't taken too well. We won the test series, but we got beaten in the third test. And when Australia lost a test, it was studied long into the night to work out what went wrong. That was the case, and 1986 came around then after it. And I remember I got asked by the ARL bosses. John Quayle was there, and Ken Arthurson. And Ken basically just said, mate, we're going to put Donnie Ferner as coach this year. And I said, this is going to make it sound like I've said get him out. And he said, well, we'll make sure that we deliver the message that it wasn't you that put him out. We've made the judgment on Don as coach, and I used to call him the most casual coach that he, and casual meant he never got into a bad mood. He used to see that as very painful for the team, and he used to spend short amounts of time with different players in finding out what made them, what were their biggest benefits, and did they have any faults or irregularities. And if they did, he used to keep it to himself, and then say to me as the captain, I think these blokes will work best together. And in that 86 tour, we had Miles and Meninga as the two Queensland centres. Donnie Furness said to me, I'm going to put Gene Miles and Brett Kenny. Miles is the best ball carrier. He will hold it like he's got an orange in his hand and put it high, low, and get the ball around the corner. And he said, and Brett Kenny is the best gap hitter I've ever seen in my life. And I said, well, second to that, he left me on my face enough times. So we had that, and Mal was sitting on the interchange bench, which was unbelievable. It was the only time he pretty much did that. But to have Miles and Kenny working outside of me, I had guys that basically ran into holes the best possible time, perfect time during the game, and we had an enormously successful run. And it I've got to say it was probably my favourite time in life. Also, it was an extremely happy period of my life. We went to England not long after the birth of my first child, Mitchell. And I was a happy man, and to be able to, the hard part was to be in England and, you know, want to spend some time at home, certainly on the phone. It was a period of my life which I can honestly say was the most happiest time in my life. A time that when I was able to play in England, which to me, and I'm not pissing in your pocket, but when you play over there, you are given the greatest challenge and the toughest hardships, where the fans and the opposition players make sure that your challenge is as tough as you will ever come up against in your lifetime. It is something quite extraordinary.
Do you think back then, playing for us, obviously Origin goes up a level. Would it be fair to say back then, playing Test match football went up another level from Origin?
Oh yeah, it did. 82, we were over there, and we, without being disrespectful, we flogged England, Great Britain, in the Test matches. France was pretty much they did that very easily. It wasn't a tough game at all. But 86, I think that was, I don't mean to start an argument on which was the best team, 82 or 86, but that was a team that we were allowed to produce whatever talents we had. And when I, assessed the quality of the players that we were against in 86, and that was when Ellery was pretty much producing his best. Gary Schofield was lightning. He was unbelievably quick. And Andy Gregory, I remember him. He used to tell me everything about my mother or my wife on the footy field. At the end of it, he'd pat you on the back. Come on, let's go and share a pint. And away we'd go. But they had a wonderful side. You know, it was a real challenge. And for me, I often say that was the most challenging but impressive period of my life, inspiring period of my life, playing over there in some of those Test matches. And when we'd come home, we'd think, oh, you beauty, we finished 3 months in England where they've tried us. And then mid-season the next year, we'd play against New Zealand. And the teams that they had, Mark Graham, Olsen Filipana, the guys that would be involved in those matches was something quite extraordinary. And it was a moment of my life where I felt good every game because the matches were so hard. And it was a thrill to play in them. It was an honour, should we be successful. And if and when we got beaten, it was very difficult to accept. But for the game of rugby league, it was exceptional.
you know what, Matt? I speak to you. Spoke with Shane Webke earlier today. A number of people that just loved playing for Australia, and the prestige that came with wearing that kangaroo jersey, and the level of importance that the public gave it, that the NRL made it important as well. They prioritised it, and as you know, for me, I used to love watching my international rugby league, playing it was, you know, being English, it was the pinnacle. Obviously, we didn't get the opportunity to play in anything like Origin, but I just don't know. It's kind of sad that it's not where it once was. Now, I know Origin has overtaken it, but I don't know. I think when you hear stories like yourself, like I say with Shane Webke, like, I think there needs to be.
Oh, I agree with you, mate. I'm glad you actually said that, because a lot of people will sort of say, you know, the Origin matches, they're the match of the year. You can't, and they are wonderful matches, but surely the greatest honour that you can ever have is representing your country. And when you go out in those games, you find that they are tougher and they're completely different style of football than you will play at State of Origin. The pride that people have, and when they're being cheered on by the country, and when we were playing in Leeds, I can remember the thrill I got out of that. In Wigan, I often used to get told by people that had been there before and judges of footy that that was the home of footy. That's where the backbone of the place was.
Was that Central Park?
Central Park, yeah, yeah. Which was an interesting field, and then playing at Hull. One of the guys used to say, Hull, it's a different place. It's a different place. And I used to say, shit, the one thing you can guarantee there, you will, again, to bring that line back in, you'll find out more about your wife, your girlfriend or your mother, or be told about it. The people let you know exactly how they feel about you. But rugby league was the winner at the end of the game. It was a remarkable place. And I still say, when I'm talking about in Origin, you know, people say it's the greatest honour of your life playing Origin. And I said, well, it's my greatest honour playing in Australia. I said, Test match footy has got to be at the top of the tree. Mm-hmm. And I said, and playing the Tests in England against the people over there, as well as the players that you're lining up against, that was it. Mm-hmm. And you know, it was sad to not have Origin mm-hmm. at the top.
Yeah. I think as well that there's something about playing in the English sort of very late autumn, early winter that sort of adds to the spectacle a little bit. Like, it's dark, it's cold, there's a crispness in the air, and it's you know, the atmosphere. You know, every time you breathe out, it's like the smoke breathes out. You're like, oh, geez, we're on it. You can smell the wintergreen almost in the
And we were playing at 2:30 or 3 o'clock maximum in the afternoon, and quite often it was dark by the time
you'd play, you'd start in daylight, half time, go in, come back out, and the floodlights are on. You're like, what? Yeah.
What have they done here? They turned the lights off, and the lights would be on. But the great thing about it was the spirit of the people, and I say that, you know. I love the spirit of the Australian people here, but the game was born in England. It was brought across here, and to be able to play on that location as the enemy is something quite extraordinary. You know that it will build you to produce your best performance of your life, because you know that if you don't, you're not getting beaten by 13 players and 4 interchange guys. You're getting beaten by another 30 or 40,000 people. Yeah. And they'll never, ever let you forget that for the rest of your life.
Yeah. Well, some of my fondest footballing memories are wearing the England shirt. I had some great series battles with the Kiwis. And, you know, the World Cup final, 2017, played Australia. It was 6-0. Like, on a fast track in Brisbane, 6-0. Like, just... The intensity was through the roof. And even, you know, a couple of months after that game, and even listening to some of the interviews, you know, speak to some of those Australian players, they were like, mate, it was like the Origin pace. It was insane.
Yeah.
And I wish we could not just bring it back, but have it at that intensity and the and the level of importance and everything that, that it should be. On that international game, I want to ask you, you've got the ball, you need to win. Who would you want to be passing the ball to get you the victory? Which teammate would you be, what would be top of the list if you could take yourself back there now? You're there playing for Australia. Who do you want to give the ball to get the match win and try?
One player.
Who would you go to?
Gino. Yeah, I'm tossing one here between Gene and Mel. Probably because I played more with Gene, I'll lean towards him a little bit. He was someone that he knew my game backwards. Wherever we went at training, we used to try these things that were you wouldn't get the green light from other coaches to do them. I used to have this thing called outback, and I think we did it. We used to practice at every training session. I think we only did it in one game, and it did work. I'd run into a player and simply put the defensive hand up and just hold it out the back, and he'd come and angle. Just every now and then he'd call for it, I'd flick it, and he'd catch it. We only got to do it successfully on the field on one occasion, but there were times, the amount of times that we practiced that, and also some other, you know, short things in the Winter Manly training sessions, in the
just like little little moves,
yep,
disguises of passes, that
yep,
sort of thing,
yep,
like unorthodox plays,
yep. And the other one was to use a I brought the spiral pass into rugby league. No one had seen it in league, and when I started doing it, every school kid in the country was doing it in 12 or 18 months. And what are you doing out there? Why do you throw it that way? And I said, well, because you can throw it a lot further and get it. And I said, I brought it from rugby union.
I
learned it in rugby union while I was at high school. I went to Brisbane State High, and there was a guy that was playing in the first, I was in grade 9, and there was a guy that was playing in the first 15 called Mark Porter. He went on, he was playing, I think, for the East Club in Brisbane, and I used to watch him every lunchtime and after school when we were training, and he'd be throwing these spiral passes, and he'd start throwing them like 5 metres and just hitting a bucket, and he'd hit it, and then he'd stretch that out, and he'd get to about 15 metres, 20 metres, and on the weekends I'd watched him while he was playing in our first 15, and he used to be able to throw this magnificent pass that allowed the intended ball catcher so much more time. There was another guy there that used to drop field goals, which, typical rugby move, you know, take 3 points. But the pass that Mark had, I thought, I want to use that. So I started doing it, and years later, every kid in the footy world was using it, bringing it in, and it was something that I used to think that was the best weapon that I had, and it was certainly worth its weight in gold.
Mate, it's something that we just take for granted, the spiral pass now. Mm. It's hard to imagine what it was like before it.
Yep, it was just a thing. Before then, everyone used to get the ball and they'd just throw it, like the ball would be standing up, and sometimes it would remain that way, otherwise it would sort of spin around once or twice and the intended ball receiver would simply catch it. And just to see why he did it, and I used to ask him, you know, why you did that, why do you... And he used to say, give the 5/8 or the fullback, a lot of the times it used to be, throw one to him and he'd kick the damn ball out. And that was, you know, go to the line out, you beauty.
Yeah.
There's an exciting play. but it gave them more time. And I thought, well, to be able to do that, so I started to bring that in and was able to use it in, you know, several of the big games.
Did you get any pushback from the coaches? Like, oh, don't bring any of that fancy stuff. Or was it accepted?
No. Instantly. My coach at Valleys, was John Rhodes. He was an international centre, played for Australia, and he sort of didn't have too much concentration on the benefits of it. He used to say, oh, yeah, if you want to do that. The next year I was under Ross Strudwick. And with him, that's when I started using that virtually every play. And I'd get it and I'd throw it out to Ross. He'd be 20 metres away. And he'd be lining up the three or four attackers that were going to try and make the most of a slim defensive line. So I used to throw them. I'd get there before training and after training and just practice them. And he'd get there with me as well. And then some nights he used to say, I've had a gutful of this. You know, you're hitting the mark. You're hitting the mark. And I said, yeah, well, might be the ones that I'm hitting the mark with. I said, it's the ones that don't hit the mark that I fear. They don't get them.
I think that's important to note that you're quite innovative in the world of rugby league. Like that would be a complete and utter game changer, bringing in the spiral pass, like what it would do to the opportunities it presents for teammates, the doubt it puts in the opposition. It would completely change the game. And it's interesting to hear that. Again, we have a lot of guests on this podcast that have been really high achievers in the game of rugby league, and they speak about doing those little extras all the time, just practicing that pass, you know, to perfect it. And I think it's really interesting that how you learnt it, asking, and it's a great lesson to anybody out there, ask questions. You see somebody doing something, even in other sports, go and ask a question. How can we take the best of all the things and make it our own?
Yeah, and it spread too, James. I mean, you know, I started doing it in Brisbane, and some of the things that I remember Ross Strudwick said to me, have you seen they're all doing it in Sydney now? And it used to sort of make me smile. I used to think, oh, well, but he used to turn around then and said, just make sure the next one hits me there, not there, not there, behind or too high. So, you know, you can bring any new skill or function into the game, but if it's not perfect, and it's not beneficial, well, it won't last long.
Mate, you wouldn't have enjoyed playing with me. I used to say to my dummy halves, no spirals.
Just pop it up.
Just pop it. No spirals, please. Like Michael Ennis used to hate it.
Yeah.
But mate, no, don't be spiraling it to me. the problem of being a dummy half is you've got to deal with people who are like that. Like, and he's got to remember. You know, it's Jimmy. I've got to pass it normally to him. And they're not that hard to catch. It was weird, unless I was off the rock, I'd get a spiral because it's the only way you could get it there, but just normal.
Yeah. Like I was asked once, when you saw that pass, did you instantly know that was the best pass you'd ever seen? I said, well, no. The best pass that I've ever seen was always the one from Arthur Beetson. He'd go and he'd throw a pass. It might only go half a metre. Others, maybe a metre, and that was it. He'd run into the opposition, and his ability to attract, he all had a magnetic attraction where he'd bring them in, and you'd see him with his arm out, and the ball would be flipped out from under the arm or out the back and sideways. And the thrill of watching him when I was a boy growing up, you know, just had me experiencing the value of using something that other people didn't. And if you can come up with something that's new or something that's not used by others that proves to be beneficial, we'll use it 7 days a week and don't waste it.
Yeah, and you can take advantage of it as well. You certainly did that. Well, mate, we're close to the end now. We've got a section of the show, all thanks to Tooheys. We have the Dream Spine. Now, we would like you to... There's no rules around this, so the 1, 6, 7, and 9, that is in your dreams. Tooheys are all about teamwork, and every great team needs a great spine. So I'm really, really interested to hear Wally Lewis's dream spine.
1, 6, 7, 9. Billy Slater at 1.
He's a common choice.
6. Oh, this is going to be a tough one. I'd put Brett Kenny mixed with Cam Munster.
Okay. Yeah.
7. Oh, this is not fair. Andrew Johns. Partnered with Jonathan Thurston. Oh, it's hard. Let me toss a coin on
that
one.
Yeah.
Freakish footballers. Absolutely freakish footballers. And nine, Cam Smith.
Mm.
I remember the days watching Cam's dad play when he was playing at Eastern Brisbane here. And they were talking about his kid. You know, what about his boy? He's coming in. He'll make it in first grade. I reckon he's going to say, oh, okay, that'll be interesting. And sort of didn't take as much notice as I should have. And then saw him come in. And he was, he had time. He had more time than anybody that I've seen playing the game. Thurston always had plenty of time and space to work in. But I think Cam Smith had it because he forced it to play a role. He'd take his time. And sometimes it looked like you think, oh, God, has he had a big night on the drink? He's just sort of jogging up to get to the dummy half position and looking around. And having been there previously, you think, no, he's dictating terms. He's playing the game the way that he wants to do it. And it was a thrill to watch him. He was something quite extraordinary. And I often get asked about, the best in those positions. When they had to work together at club level, certainly I can't leave Thurston out, but when it was at club level and Melbourne Storm were at their best, and they had Billy, Cooper Cronk, and Cam Smith, wow.
Yeah.
What an outfit they were. They were something quite extraordinary. Mm.
How do you think you'd have gone up against those sort of players? Would you enjoy the challenge?
And I think the better the opponent is, the greater your challenge and the more reward you see yourself getting at the end of it, if it's successful.
Well, I was going to say, would you rather play with them or play against them?
I had the thrill of playing with Gene Miles and Brett Kenny in the centres for Australia. I might have said that before, didn't I? And we had Mal, went to the reserves bench, and he played a bit of time at second row. To play them is a thrill. To play against them is the greatest personal challenge you will ever give yourself. And that would have been fantastic. When I used to play against Brett, six on six, it was remarkable. There were some comical moments in some of the things that happened, some of the things we said to each other, where we were on the field. So I think it was the greatest benefit the greatest benefit when you're having the opportunity to play alongside them in your team, but the greatest challenge of all is when you're against them and you come up. And if you get to be successful on that day, I think you sit down at the end of it and you think, I think I've done a fair job.
Yeah. It is funny that, even like myself, I got to play with Sam Burgess but also against him, and I don't know which one I enjoyed more. I loved playing with him.
Yeah.
Like, loved it.
Yeah.
But then playing against him was like, whoa.
Yeah.
Like, I've got to be at my best today. It's funny how that works, isn't it? It's,
yeah.
It's strange, that is remarkable. That is a remarkable spine, and big thanks to Tooheys, because they're all about teamwork, and every great team needs a great spine. So thank you for contributing there. Some of the questions we ask each and every guest, a sliding doors moment where you think about the alternative happening. So for me, it might be if I'd have stayed in England, what life would have been like. Is there anything that springs to mind for you where you think about the other thing?
If I had have gone to Sydney and played at Manly, I got the best of both worlds to play in the competition, where people were saying you can't prove yourself unless you prove yourself in the Sydney comp. The Broncos come along, so that was it. But had I have gone to Manly, I often wonder what it was like. Fatty used to try and talk me into it and say, you've got to do it. You'll be enjoying yourself so much more. well, it might have been good, but I often find that, I was spoiled a little bit too in the quality of player I had around me here in Brisbane, which was, as my dad used to say, I was glad when you said no to Sydney, because you know that when you play here in Brisbane, you're forced to perform a little bit better each and every week. If you went down there and you had all those other great players around you, you might have said, oh, well, I don't have to do much today, just tip it on, pass the ball on, give it to him. But when you need to be at your best and enjoy doing it quite regularly, that's, I think, at the end of the day that you feel most comfortable of all and realise that playing that game has made you a much better footballer and a much better person.
Yeah, no doubt. If football didn't exist, what do you think Wally Lewis would have done?
Mate, I was a numbskull at school. I certainly did not give my teachers too much time marking my exam papers. I didn't do too well in that. What would I have done? I would have been involved in some other sport. What would it be? Probably cricket. I enjoyed playing cricket, and there were the days when, just to tell a story very quickly, the boss of the Broncos, Barry Maranta, he was the man in charge. There was four of them. He had a son, Michael Maranta, who's a wonderfully talented cricketer, played very good rugby as well at Gregory Terrace. There were, a number of opportunities, I think, but we were playing cricket, and I used to think probably that I was a bit better cricketer than I was. Went in second drop, Brisbane State High versus Gregory Terrace, and the wicket was taken. I'm next batsman in. He's come up, his left arm, very quick pace bowler, played and missed. And got the, and I've looked up at him, a bit nervous. And here comes the second ball. I've played it, missed. And he's gone down. I'm wondering, what have I got to do to get this bum out? And I said, just bowl the ball. And he's gone back and come in the next one and went whack, straight back over his head. And the umpire's turned around. He's watching how close the ball is getting to the boundary. And Michael just stood there with his hands on his hips, right in the middle of the pitch where I was sort of running down the side. And I thought, he's not moving. So I just changed the bat and that and went whack. And I hit him and he went down and he was smothered his face. And I could hear all these players go, oh, no. And the umpire thought, well, I was watching the ball down there. And he's laying there and they were all blowing up deluxe. And anyway, I'm starting to think, oh, well, I can't get any trouble here. And my school coach, Mr. Luke Remedios, he came out onto the field and they're all sort of pushing and doing a bit of pushing and shoving. And he grabbed me by the ear, squeezed my ear, and he said, umpire, this batsman is officially retired. And he dragged me off. I got a hiding with a cane the next time.
Did you?
On the Monday. Yeah, I got reported and I made a dickhead of myself. Yeah, I got the cane on the Monday. That was on a Saturday. And Michael did very well. And I thought, well, geez, he was a Sheffield Shield quality bowler. He's fantastic and a good guy. But that's the way that we were while we were at school. We used to think, we'll prove how tough we are. And it had nothing to do with it. He was a wonderful cricketer. I was just a mug that was swinging the bat and having a go.
Got lucky.
Got lucky on the
day. Did it go for six in the end?
No. It went down. Might have got to the boundary at the four, but that was it. That was as close as I got to being a cricketer.
Well, final question. You've met and come across so many people in this wonderful life that you've had, but who would you describe as the most interesting?
My dad. He was the most special guy. He taught me the most about football. I lost him recently, just a few weeks ago. And he was the guy that used to tell me things about the game that I'd sort of look at, and he'd say, you've got to improve this if you want to make it. Different areas of the game. And I can remember one Origin game in particular. I went back to see him, and I was as pleased as punch. And him and Mum used to watch the videos, the old VHS things, a few times. And she came in and said, oh, you'd be very happy with that. You come back, you've proved the people in Sydney wrong. And I said, oh, yeah, I was really happy. Got those, you know, those passes they got, and I threw them, and Gino scored, or somebody, whoever it was, scored. So Dad said, so are you happy with all of that? And I said, yeah, I'm really happy with it. And he said, well, you missed three tackles. And I turned around and I looked at Mum, and she just sort of put the eyes up, and she said, he's watched the game a few times so far. And I said, okay, so it's all about that. So he used to look at me and he said, don't ever put yourself down for not having to do something better. And he used to describe that a little bit later in life and say that also, you know, is all about being a father as well.
Mm.
He was a great man.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry to hear of his recent passing, but it's clear even in the interview you speak so highly of him.
I almost brought it up at the start when we were talking about dementia, and I used to go over there all the time, and he'd I'd say, how you going? He'd say, oh, how's Jackie and the kids? And I said, oh, Dad, actually, we're divorced. We've separated. And he'd say, oh, that's no good. That's no good. And he'd sit there in front of the TV, and 10 minutes later, he said, oh, Wally's here. Oh, when did you arrive? You've just snuck in. Oh, how's Jackie and the kids? And he'd do that 30 or 40 times, one after another. And it made going and visiting the greatest man in my life uncomfortable. But I still got around there, still got to see him. But it was particularly sort of aggressive when I felt that I was dealing with a similar, and I should have brought it up before, but a similar issue than he is. Because memories just don't exist or didn't exist in his life at the end. They were very sad.
Yeah, but it's still there. Still there.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. And they never die.
Mm.
Like, it's funny, like, having the, my nan is really suffering with dementia as well at this present time. And obviously I'm removed because I'm over in the other side of the world and speak to Mom. And yeah, there's some difficult times there, but I think it's important that we, and I try to encourage my mum to remember that this isn't who we should remember her as.
Yeah,
the person that you sat and watched, you know, the football with is the person you should remember, and the lessons that he taught you, and working on different things. I think that's the important thing. We can get caught in the present a little bit, but I think the memories never die.
Yeah, the memories. The time that he spent, I often used to talk about it, saying, you know, I was the biggest pest of a son. He used to arrive home when it was cricket season. He'd arrive home from work and he'd be bowling me balls until we couldn't see the cricket ball anymore, until it was that dark. And in footy season, he'd arrive home from work and I'd be practicing the skills in the backyard and how do you do this and how you do that. And he'd always go out there and, you know, I don't ever remember him sort of saying, I can't be bothered. He was always given time to do it. And I answered that question about who was the person that that helped me become the footy player that that I probably did was certainly my father.
Mm. Yeah, it's a big lesson, that, and clearly a big influence. And you just think back to the people that are special in your life, and they give you the greatest thing, and that's their time.
Mm.
Like after a hard day's work, and then come back and to keep bowling the cricket ball and keep passing the footy.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an example of an amazing man. So, and thank you for sharing that with us, Wally, and thank you for coming on the show. It's it means a lot. It really does. Obviously the icon that you are, the person that you are, for me, just a lad from Liverpool in the north of England to be sat across the table from the world's greatest ever rugby league player is a pretty surreal moment. So thank you.
My pleasure, mate. Anytime.